And Junior was practically crawling out the window, screaming and hollering and crying because his dad was going to whip his ass. I wasn't scared. I mean, I rarely got reprimanded for mistakes that I had made. I was, you know, I wasn't scared. But I remember that vividly. And so, yeah, some of my early memories were 44th in Portland. And there I learned to ride a bike. I started learning to ride a bike on a girl's bike, one of those 70s bikes with the banana seat. And it was a girl's bike. And I remember my Uncle Paul, who I kind of thought of as my brother at the time, because we lived together. He was my grandmother's youngest son who still lived with us. He was trying to teach me how to ride a bike. And I remember him like putting me in front and, you know, telling me to pedal, and I was just scared, but I would just sit on the lowest bar and sort of scoot myself around on this bike. I don't know why they got me a girl's bike, but they did. But that's where I learned to ride a bike. And I remember my Uncle John one time, he took me to buy a new bike. And I'd just seen advertisements for the Huffy Thunder Road bicycle, and I wanted that one. And we went to the store, and he said I could pick out any bike I wanted. Now, there were, some of you may remember the Schwinn Stingrays with the little stick shift and everything, and I mean, I should have got that. That was way cooler. And he wanted me to get that, you know. I mean, it was very cool. He understood, but I was sold on the Huffy Thunder Road advertisements with the knobby tires, the waffle knobby tires, and I thought it was so cool. And it had a little square racing plate in front and a little oval racing plate in the middle, and I thought that was the coolest thing. Well, we had bought this bike, and the same day I brought it home, I was riding it around my block, and some kids stopped on the corner and said, "Hey, that's a great bike, you know." You know, they were very friendly, and they said, "Can we ride it?" And I was like, "Okay, sure." And they were like, "Here, you can hold our bike," which was some piece of crap. And I waited on the corner, and I watched them go off into the sunset, and they never came back. And I waited, and I waited, and I waited, and pretty soon it was close to dark, and I saw my uncle coming down, and I began to cry. But he asked me where the bike was, and he got so angry. This is the only time I ever got a spanking. He gave me a really hard swap on the butt, and it made me pee my pants. You know, I got whapped on the butt so hard, and I pissed my pants, and I felt really bad. One, for making him mad. Two, for losing my bike. And three, for getting hit on the ass so hard I pissed myself. And I remember sitting in the kitchen with my Aunt Lorraine. She had a nickname, Itchy. I don't know why, but we were sitting in the kitchen, and I saw my bike go by with those two that had stole it. And I said, "There's my bike." And I remember her, she was young at this time, she tore out the door and went running down the alley, and she didn't catch him, but I remember that pretty clearly. And this is around the time where I started preschool, and I went to a Native American school called the Heart of the Earth Survival School. And they would pick me up in a van. I was so scared. I was so scared, so frightened. They'd pick me up in the van, and they'd take me to school, and I think it was only a half a day or whatever, but I remember one time in particular in this van, I heard the song Donna Summer, Love to Love You. Now, I don't know if any of you are familiar with Donna Summer, Love to Love You, but it's, you know, it's an old disco song, and it had, you know, her moaning in the background, and it was pretty explicit for the time. It was a disco nightclub song, and they played it, and I remember being so embarrassed. You know, I would just hide myself because this woman was moaning on the radio, and I didn't understand, you know, about it, but I knew it made me embarrassed. So those are my first memories of school, the heart of the earth, and it was located in the Dinkytown area of Minneapolis, which is the campus area of the Minnesota University of Minnesota, around that area. And
hi, I'm Christina,
and I remember that school very well. I remember the meals they used to feed us, and then I remember actually going to kindergarten in first grade at Hale Elementary in South Minneapolis, and I was excited because I got to go to school with Junior finally, you know, and the bus would pick us up on the corner. And that's pretty exciting. I remember for the first time waiting on the corner and it started to rain, only the rain was coming from the left-hand side and I could see, I was dry. One part over here was hadn't been rained on, you know, it was coming from the left to the right. Now I saw it coming down the road and pretty soon it engulfed, you know, everything, but I remember thinking how strange it was that the rain, I could see the rain coming toward me and finally raining over everything. But I have fond memories of Hale. That was my first time having a little kid crush on a girl. Her name was Jill. And this other little boy had a mad crush on her. I just kind of thought she was cute or whatever, but this boy was really infatuated with her. And I remember saying, well, I like Jill, and we kind of got into this little kid rival at kindergarten age, 5 years old. And I remember him wanting to put up his dukes, you know, over the matter, and I thought it was so funny to egg him on and, you know, just get a rise out of this kid over Jill. And before the actual little fight started, it was broken up by the teacher. But yeah, so that was one of the things I remember about Hale Elementary. The building's still there, as far as I know. By the way, the year is 2017, it's February. So, as a child, I was a loner. I still am. But I had a vivid imagination. Since I was a loner, I had an overactive imagination, and I would do these little skits down in my basement. I would just entertain myself and, you know, playing these little skits by myself in the basement of the Portland house. An interesting thing happened around 1975 or 76. It was Christmas and I was at my aunt's house, Mary Bell. Her nickname was Sony. And she had a bunch of kids. Chris, the youngest, who was my favorite. Mark, the second youngest, who's another one of my favorites. They were all my favorites. I love them all. But Chris, I was especially fond of, and I looked up to, and I wanted to be just like him. Next up was Ed. Next up from that was Curtis. And the next up from that was Wayne, the oldest. And after Wayne, I believe, was Robin, the girl. They were the oldest. They were like adults in my eyes. But one interesting thing happened, and this is pretty important to understanding me. Mark had gotten a Kiss record, Rock and Roll Over, and he opened it up. And after, you know, the Christmas festivities was over and everyone was playing with the toys, he looked at it and he was like, I don't really want this, you know. He thought it was like for kids. If you see the cover of Kiss Rock and Roll Over, it's like a cartoonish piece of art. And I looked at this thing and I couldn't believe it. You know, of course I wanted it. I took it home and it became my favorite album. Before that, what got me into music was I was playing in the alley one time and I found this suitcase looking thing and I brought it home. And it opened up, and it was a record player, and the speakers came out sideways, and I plugged it in, and it was a record player. I really hadn't seen anything like that. And one of the records that came with it was the Animals' Greatest Hits. And my Uncle Hank had fixed it. I was missing a needle, but he had took a sewing needle, burnt it, made it really hot with a lighter, and bent the very tip, and he cut it, and he put it right in the slot where the needle would be, and somehow got it to stick in there. So you'd put the arm on the needle, and it played the record. And that was my record player. That was my introduction to music, really. And I listened to It's My Life by the Animals over and over and over, maybe for a whole year. That was my favorite song. I couldn't get enough of it. And so I listened to that song over and over, and it had all the other hits like House of the Rising Sun, which scared me a little. But it was that Christmas of, I believe, 76, where I got Kiss Rock and Roll Over. And that really changed my life. From that point on, that's what I wanted to be. I didn't want to be a farmer or a policeman or a fireman or anything like that, which little boys a lot of times wanted to be. I wanted to be one of these guys. I wanted to play music. And one of the little skits I would do in the basement was I would lay down and pretend to be dead. And I'd put on the record and then I'd lay down, and when the music came on, I remember acting out like it brought me back to life, this music, and I would slowly move a finger and I'd slowly come to life because of this music. I don't know why, it's just one of those things that kids do. So I had a wild, vivid imagination from being an only child and spending a lot of time alone. And of course, later on, you know, that transferred into art and music, writing songs. I believe it all comes from the same place, you know, the same well of talent. But those are some of the memories that I have of 44th in Portland. And I remember moving with my grandma. She had gotten a different house. See, I grew up very poor. After my grandfather died, it was just me and Granny. And we were on welfare, and she had gotten her Navy pension from her husband, Lawrence. And that's all we had, so I think we survived on just a couple hundred dollars a month. And I never knew we were poor because she had kept the house immaculate, so clean that I didn't know that we were poor, or, you know, we were like under the poverty level. I didn't know that because our house was always immaculate. And I would go to other friends' house And it would be messy and dirty and unkept, and I would just think, oh, you guys must be poor, look how dirty it is, or whatever, I'm thinking that. But it wasn't until later in life that I realized how, in fact, very poor we were. But I never felt that way growing up. I was a very happy little child, aside from being very confused about why my mom didn't want me. But aside from that, I escaped all those unhappy thoughts with art and music. So in a strange way, my father figure really was Gene Simmons of Kiss. Now, to a lot of people that sounds really silly, but that's all I had. This rock band Kiss had created this entire world, you know, music, magazines, where you would go and get the latest magazine and it would have these cool posters of, you know, these Kiss guys. And, you know, I remember wanting to be Gene Simmons. That's all I ever wanted to be. So they created this whole world where you could get into, and, you know, we didn't have internet or anything like that. All we had was three or four stations on the TV and the radio and records. To some extent, 8-track tapes, but it was mainly records were the main source of music, aside from the radio. So that was my escapism. And I always wanted to emulate him, and eventually I did, you know. But back then, that was my world, and everything seemed bleak compared to Kiss and, you know, these magical, mystical figures that played this music that got me all riled up and excited. And nothing else mattered in my life except their music and their pictures, and, you know, nothing else mattered for the longest time. Everything seemed so drab compared to that. And, you know, my uncles and aunts and my grandma couldn't understand my fixation with this, but, you know, that was me. I was a little Kiss kid, just, you know. And, you know, that was my whole life up until I was a teenager when I started branching out. But so we had moved to our second house, which was 2321 East 34th Street, South Minneapolis. And I remember the first day going there on the bus, my granny and I would take the city bus everywhere. You know, I remember walking to the bus stop. That was our ritual, to walk to the bus, wait for the bus, look at it down the street if it's coming or not, and we'd sit there and wait, and finally the bus would come, and Granny and I would get on the bus, and we would go downtown and go to Woolworth, go downstairs, and we would have lunch at Woolworth, and, you know, she'd let me go and buy a toy or a record. I had started buying records by that point. And so we would take a bus everywhere. Well, one day we took a bus to the new house. And I remember walking into this house, and it seemed so incredible. It was so bright and sunny, and, you know, it had our own little backyard. On 44th in Portland, it was a duplex, so we shared. On one side was always another family. On this side was us. And, I remember that was very exciting. I remember back on Portland House, there was this girl, neighborhood girl, and there was a table. We put a blanket over and it made a little fort. And I remember she wanted to see my private parts. And I was very shy. I was like, show me yours first. And she had showed me her private parts, and I had gotten so freaked out And so grossed out, I couldn't believe it. I mean, I had never seen anything like that, and I got scared and I ran out of there, and yeah, that was kind of funny. But